Good morning, all of you. I am Dr. Abhay Deshpande, Associate Professor, RV College of Engineering, Bangalore. So this is my lecture 2. And today, we are dealing with magnetic forces, materials, and magnetism. Let us see the outline. So today I am going to deal with force and torque on a closed circuit. Second concept is nature of magnetic materials. And third one, magnetization and permeability. So these are the three concepts that I am going to deal today. So let me start with the first one, that is force and torque on a closed circuit. So the general expression for the force exerted on a current system, it is given by F is equal to minus I into integral of, for a closed path, B cross dl, where I is the current, B is the magnetic field, and dl is the element. So if we consider this magnetic flux density B is uniform, then we can write this expression of force as F is equal to minus I into B cross integral of dl for a closed path. So this is the general expression for the force. Now, the moment of force or a torque. So now the new word called as a torque, it can be defined as, that is the moment of force or a torque about a specific point. It is defined as the vector product of the moment arm R, capital R, and the force F. So this is the force F, what we have done in the general expression, and the moment arm, that is the capital R. So the cross product of these two, that is R cross F, we will call it as the moment of force, or else we will call it as a torque, that is capital T. Now, if you see this diagram, here there is an origin point O. There are two points, that is P1 and P2. P1 is at a distance of R1 from O, and P2 is at a distance of R2 from O. So this is nothing but arm. This is arm 1, that is R1, and this is arm 2, this is R2. Now in this case, I have taken two arms, R1 and R2. So since I have taken two arms, there are two forces. So let us consider the force at a P1, point P1 is F1 in this direction, and the force at a point P2, F2 is in this direction. So obviously from this figure, we can write it as F2 is equal to minus of F1 because it is in the opposite direction, and I have taken and I have considered F2 is equal to minus. Now, from the definition of the torque, that is T is equal to R into F. Now, since here you have R1 and R2, accordingly F1 and F2, we will write this equation as capital T is equal to, that is torque T is equal to R1 cross F1 plus R2 cross F2. But we know that F2 is equal to minus F1. So we can write this as F1 plus F2 is equal to 0. So if I substitute F2 is equal to minus F1 in this equation, I will get this equation as R1 cross F1 minus R2 cross F1 because I have substituted F2 is equal to minus F. So if I simplify this expression for a torque, we will get it as capital T is equal to R1 minus R2 cross F1, or we can write it as R21 cross F1, where R21 is R1 minus R2. So I have represented the R21 also in the figure. This is R21, that is R1 minus R2. So this is the torque. Here I have taken an example of two arms, that is R1 and R2. Hence I will get the torque T is equal to R21 cross F1, where R21 is R1 minus R2, and in cross of F1, that is the force. So this is how we will calculate the torque. Now let us see, there is a current loop. So there are four sides, 1, 2, 3, 4. Now I want to calculate a torque on a current loop placed in a magnetic field. In the previous example, I have taken two arms, R1 and R2. Now I am calculating what is the torque on a current loop. So I have taken a loop and there is a origin point O, and this is the distance, that is capital R, and you have four sides, 1, 2, 3, 4, and it is placed in XY plane. Hence this we will write it as a DX, and this we will write it as DY, and this is the current. So there is a magnetic field which is distributed, magnetic flux capital B is distributed. Now I am going to calculate the torque on this entire current loop. So since there are four sides, that is side 1, side 2, side 3 and side 4, I will calculate the torque on the individual sides, 1, 2, 3, 4, and then at the end, I will add all these torques to get the total torque on a current loop. So let me see for the first one, that is for the first side. Now, initially, I will write df1 is equal to idx ax cross b0. So this expression we have already derived in the previous class. So I am using this equation, that is df1 is equal to idx ax cross b0. So I think you also remember the equation. We have derived the equation as F is equal to IDL B. So here DL is nothing but DX AX. For the first side, I have taken for the first side, that is DX AX cross B naught. So I will substitute the value for AX cross B0. So AX cross B0, if I want to substitute, I know that the total value of B is equal to B0X AX plus B0Y AY plus B0Z AZ. So from this equation, if I want AX cross B0, so AX cross B0, we can write it as B0Y AZ minus B0Z AY. That is, I have replaced for AX cross B0, and we know this equation, that is for X, Y and Z coordinate. So in that, I need a cross product, that is AX cross B0. So that can be written as B0Y AZ minus बी नॉट जेड ए वन, दैट इज डी एफ वन. नाउ आई विल कैलकुलेट द टॉर्क, दैट इज डी टी वन. आई विल राइट इट इज नथिंग बट आर वन क्रॉस डी एफ वन. So DF1 is what we have derived now, and R1. Now what is the value of R1? That is the distance for the side one minus half into dy ay. So the distance. See, this is dy. So if this is dy, so the distance should be half dy ay, and it is minus sign because the side one is down. So this is the side one. So it is minus half dy ay. So minus half dy ay cross d of one value, that is idx into b naught y az minus b naught z ay. So I'll simplify this. So we will write it as minus half. So I have a dx and I have dy and I. Now I have ay component of b naught y az minus b naught z ay. So we will write this as, we will write this as minus half dx dy I. It is b naught y ax. If we simplify this, that is b naught y az minus b naught z ay with the cross product of ay. If we calculate, we will get it as b naught y ax. Correct? Because ay it is, ay component cross product, ay cross b naught y az minus b naught z ay. So we will get it as b naught y as it is into ax, because we have ay along with az. Now this is the value of dt1, that is the torque which I have calculated for side one. Now similarly, I will calculate the torque for third side, because the direction of the current is exactly opposite and remaining all terms will remain same, because even this is also distributed along dx. And this part is dy, but it is in the positive side. Since I have taken minus half, I need to take plus half. So because of this reason, I will derive for third side first. So for the third side, it is R3 cross DF3 I will write. And what is the value of R3 here? It is plus half dy ay, because for dt1 I have taken minus half dy ay, and here it is plus half dy ay. Cross product of current direction is opposite, hence instead of plus I, it is minus I. Dx ax as it is, cross b naught as it is, and again I will substitute the values and I will find out the cross product. I will get very much similar to my dt1. I will get dt3 is equal to minus half dx dy I b naught y ax. So both are same, that is dt1 now it is equal to dt3. So similarly we can derive for dt2 as well as dt4, and we will get it as plus dx into dy current I and b naught x ay, because for t1 93 we will get b0 y ax. So here we will get b0 x ay. Remaining all terms as it is. And here it is minus, and here we will get it as plus. Now I got for all the sides, that is side 1, side 2, side 3, side 4. Now I need to calculate the total torque, that is dt. So dt is equal to dt1 plus dt2 plus dt3 plus dt4. We need to add all. And we have minus dx dy I b naught y ax and dx dy I b naught x ay. Hence, we will get it as I dx dy. So inside the bracket, b naught x ay minus b naught y ax. So dt is equal to I dx dy as it is. Now this b naught x ay minus b naught y ax can be written as, this can be written as az cross b naught, because we know this expression. This expression we know. And based on this, we can write this as b naught x ay minus b naught y ax can be written as az cross b naught, cross product of az and b naught, we will get this, that is b naught x a y minus b naught y a x. Now I will get I dx dy and az cross b naught. Now I have x component, y component, as well as z component. And I can define this all x, y, z component together as a vector area ds. So I can define all x, y, z component, the total area as vector area, and we will define it as ds. So what is the torque equation we will get now? Dt is equal to I as it is ds cross b. So this is the torque, that is I ds cross b. Now based on this concept, we will define one more term called as magnetic dipole moment. That is nothing but the product of the loop current and the vector area of the loop. So in the equation, if you see the product of the loop current, that is I, and the vector area, what is the area? Ds is called as magnetic dipole moment, that is dm. So we will define this Ids term as magnetic dipole moment, and we will write it as a dm. Hence dm is equal to Ids. So I will substitute this dm in the equation of a total torque. Then I will get dt is equal to dm cross b. So hence I will write the total torque capital T is equal to I into S cross b, that is equal to m cross b. That is the total torque which relates between the magnetic dipole moment and the magnetic flux density, that is the torque capital T. Now we will do one simple example to understand the concept of torque. That is, first example, the loop has dimensions of 1 meter by 2 meter and the loop current is 4 milliamp. So there is a loop, and loop current is 4 milliamp, and the dimension of a loop is 1 meter by 2 meter. It lies in the uniform field D naught is equal to minus 0.6 AY plus 0.8 AZ. Now calculate the torque. Now torque equation is IS cross B. The torque equation is I ds. What is the ds? Dx into dy, that is az. So IS cross B, that is the total torque. So I will substitute all the values, that is current I, S value and B value. Current I is 4 milliamp, that is 4 into 10 to the power minus 3. And S, that is the vector area. So what is the vector area? If I take 1 meter by 2 meter in XY plane, then I will get 1 into 2 into AZ. Cross product of B. What is the B value? Minus 0.6 AY plus 0.8 AZ. Now calculate the cross product of this. That is, I have AZ with AY and AZ with AZ. So I have AZ with AY, hence I will get AX component. So I will get AZ cross AY alone. AZ and AZ will be 0. So AZ cross AY component, I will get it as 4.8 AX millinewton into meters. So what is the value of a torque now? That is 4.8 AX newton meter into meters. So this is how we will calculate the torque of a closed loop. Now we will go to the next concept, that is nature of magnetic materials. So here we will come to know what is the nature of magnetic materials and what are all the different classification of magnetic materials. We will come to know in this concept. Now, if you consider an atom, there are three important contributions for this angular moment of atom. So those three contributions are, first one is orbital magnetic dipole moment, second one is electron spin magnetic moment, and third one is nuclear spin magnetic moment. So we will see what is this orbital, electron and nuclear. As the name itself suggests, first one, orbital, that is the orbital electron produce magnetic field. So it produces always a magnetic field in such a way to align with an external magnetic field with no other magnetic moments considered. So this is called as orbital electron, and the magnetic field generated by this, we will call it as the first one, orbital magnetic dipole moment. Second one, that is the angular momentum of an electron, we will call it as spin of the electron. And this nuclear spin, it contributes to the magnetic moment called nuclear spin magnetic moment. So this concept is very much similar to the one what we have done in electrostatics. So similarly, we have in magnetic field, that is orbital magnetic, electron spin and nuclear spin. Now based on these three contributions for the angular moment of an atom, we will classify the magnetic materials into six types. So there are six different types of materials that we are going to define now. So let us define the first one, that is the magnetic material in which the orbital magnetic moment and electron spin magnetic moment cancel each other, making net permanent magnetic moment of each atom zero, are called as diamagnetic material. So that means both the orbital magnetic moment as well as electron spin magnetic moment, they'll cancel each other and they'll make the net magnetic field is equal to zero. And such a type of a material, we will call it as diamagnetic materials. Second one, the magnetic material in which the orbital and spin magnetic moments do not cancel each other, resulting in a net magnetic field of an atom, are called as paramagnetic material. That means orbital and spin magnetic moments, they will not cancel each other. That means there is a net magnetic moment of an atom, and we will call that type of materials as paramagnetic materials. Third one, the materials in which the atoms have large dipole moment due to electron spin magnetic moments, and such a type of materials we will call it as ferromagnetic materials. That means they have very large dipole moment because of electron spin magnetic moment, and we will name it as ferromagnetic materials. Next one, the materials in which the dipole moments of adjacent atoms line up in anti-parallel fashions. So they will line up in anti-parallel fashion. That means the dipole moments, and such a materials we will call it as anti-ferromagnetic materials. For example, oxides, chlorides and sulfides, they are all good examples of anti-ferromagnetic materials. Next one, the materials in which the magnetic dipole moments are lined up in anti-parallel fashion, but the net magnetic moment is non-zero. If the net magnetic moment is non-zero, in such a case, we will call that type of materials as ferrimagnetic material. And the best examples are nickel ferrite, nickel zinc ferrite, and iron oxide magnetite. These are the examples of ferrimagnetic type materials. The last one, in supermagnetic materials, each particle of it contains large magnetic domains but cannot penetrate adjacent particles. Such a materials we will call it as supermagnet. That means the particle contains very large magnetic domains but cannot penetrate to adjacent particles. So best example is magnetic tails, which are used in audio and videos. So we will summarize all these six type of classifications, that is diamagnetic, paramagnetic, ferromagnetic, anti-ferrimagnetic, ferrimagnetic and supermagnetic. So These are the magnetic moments, B values, and these are the commands. That means this table will give you a summary of the classifications of the magnetic materials, what we have done. Now, the next concept is magnetization and permeability. So, what do you mean by magnetization and permeability? We will see in this concept. Now let me begin with the bound current. Now we have seen the orbital, the spin, electron spin, and the nuclear spin in different types of magnetic materials, what we have done. Now, the total current produced by the bound charges. Now what are all the bound charges? That is orbital electrons, electron spin, and the nuclear spin. So the current produced because of all these bound charges, we will call it as bound current, and we will denote it as I suffix B. So I suffix B stands for bound current. Now the field produced due to movement of bound charges is called as magnetization, capital M. So if there is a generation of the field because of the movement of these bound charges, that means movement of orbital electrons or electron spin or the nuclear spin, such a field we will call it as magnetization, and we will denote it as capital M. So we will derive the expression for permeability. We will see what you mean by permeability at the end of the derivation. Now, the magnetic dipole moment M is defined as M is equal to IBDS. We know that the magnetic dipole is IDS, and in this case it is IB stands for the bound current, and the DS, that is the vector area. We have done this already in the previous concept. So for entire thing, that is for I tends to 1 to n delta V, for the entire volume delta V, if we sum together, then we will get the total magnetic dipole moment, that is M total. Now the magnetization M is equal to limit as delta V tends to 0, 1 divided by delta V into sum of or summation of I is equal to 1 to n delta V of Mi. So this is nothing but the magnetization, that is the field which is generated because of the movement of bound charges, that is the dipole moment. So the differential change in the net bound current over segment DL. Now let us consider a segment DL, and the differential change in the net bound current is IB. The differential change in the current IB because of the segment DL can be written as DIB is equal to M, that is the magnetization dot DL. Because there is a change in the net bound current, that means there is a change in the bound charges. Hence, there is change in the bound current. And since there is a change in the bound current, that change can be written as M dot BL, because the change is because over a segment DL. So I have taken a segment DL, hence because of that segment DL, there is a differential change in the net bound current, that is DI. So from this, I can write IB is equal to integral of M dot DL for a closed loop, that is the line integral we are doing to calculate the value of IB. Now, using Ampere circuital law in terms of the total current, we will write total current IT. I will denote total current as IT and bound current as IB. Now, using Ampere circuital law, we can write it as B divided by mu naught dot DL is equal to IT, where B is the magnetic flux density, DL is a segment for a small segment, DL, and mu naught is the permeability of free space. We will calculate the values. Now let I is the total free current enclosed by the closed path. So let us consider a new current I, which is free current enclosed by the path. Then the total current, what is the total current now? Is it not total current is equal to bound current IB plus the current which is enclosed by the closed path, that is current I. So current, total current IT is equal to IB plus I. So from this, what is the total free current enclosed by the path? That is I is equal to total current minus bound current, because we know the total current. So this is the total current. So this is for air, minus the bound current IB we have calculated in the previous expression. IB is equal to integral of M dot DL, and IT is equal to B by mu naught dot DL. And we substitute those two equations. We will get I is equal to IT minus IB is equal to integral of IT value. IT value is B by mu naught dot DL, and IB value is M dot DL. Hence, I will take DL outside for a line integral in a closed path, and I will get this as B divided by mu naught minus M. Now, if you compare this expression with the Ampere circuital law, then is it not B by mu naught minus M? It should be is equal to the field intensity, magnetic field intensity capital H, Ampere circuital law, H dot DL is equal to I. Hence, instead of H here, B by mu naught minus M. So B by mu naught minus M can be written as capital H. So from this, we will write it as B is equal to, what is the magnetic flux density? B is equal to mu naught into H plus M, where H is field intensity and M is the magnetization. So for all the three currents, that is the bound current, the total current, and the free current, what we have seen, enclosed by the closed path, for all the three currents can be written in terms of current density, that is J. So for first one it is JB dot DS, for total current it is JT dot DS, and for the free current it is J dot DS. And the same current density expressions can be written as JV is del cross M, JT is del cross B divided by mu naught, and J is del cross H. So we have defined three different current densities, J, JT, and JB, based on three different currents. Now we have a new word called as magnetic susceptibility XM. That is, for a linear isotropic medium, the magnetic susceptibility XM, which relates between M and H as M is equal to XM dot H, that is the susceptibility. So in the equation of B is equal to mu naught into H plus M, we will substitute the value of H and M, that is M is equal to XMH, that is susceptibility into H, and this H as it is, and if I take H outside, I will get mu naught into 1 plus susceptibility into H, and 1 plus susceptibility is called as mu R, which is nothing but relative permeability. Now permeability, mu R is nothing but 1 plus magnetic susceptibility, and permeability is nothing but mu. So mu is equal to mu naught into mu R, where mu naught is for free space and mu R is for any medium, that is relative permeability. Hence this equation we will write it as B is equal to mu into H, where mu is equal to mu naught into mu R, where mu R is relative permeability and mu naught is for free space. So this is how we have different equations for magnetization, magnetic susceptibility, permeability, relative permeability, and all the current densities, different currents in the concept of magnetization and permeability. Now let us do one simple numerical on this. That is, given a ferrite material that we shall specify to be operating in linear mode with B is equal to 0.05 Tesla, and let us assume the value of mu R is equal to 50 and calculate the values of magnetic susceptibility, magnetization M, and magnetic field intensity H. Now we have seen different equations. Now we have to use those equations to solve this numerical. Now what is the susceptibility? XM is equal to, that is mu R is equal to 1 plus magnetic susceptibility, and we need susceptibility value, that means mu R minus 1. So mu R minus 1 is equal to, mu R value is 50 minus 1 is equal to 49. That is magnetic susceptibility we got. Now second thing is, I need the value of H, but we know from the previous expression B is equal to mu naught mu R H, and from this H is equal to B divided by mu naught into mu R, and H is equal to B value they have given 0.05 Tesla divided by mu naught into mu R. What is mu R? Relative permeability. How much they have given? 50. And what is a mu naught for a free space? It is 4 pi into 10 to the power minus 7. Absolute value we will call. So H is equal to 0.05 divided by 50 into 4 pi into 10 to the power minus 7. So it is very much similar to epsilon in case of electrostatics what you have done. Epsilon is equal to epsilon naught into epsilon r. Here mu is equal to mu naught into mu r. So from this we will calculate the value of H is equal to 796 ampere per meter. And we will calculate the value of M. M is equal to magnetic susceptibility into H, and XM value we have calculated 49 into H value is 796 ampere per meter. And calculate the value of M, which is nothing but 39,000 ampere per meter. So this is how we can calculate the values of m h b magnetic susceptibility, current densities we have. So all the equations are very much important to solve the numericals. Now based on this concept, let us answer a few quick quiz questions. Ferrites are special dash materials having very low electric conductivity. The answer is fourth one, that is ferrimagnetic materials. That means ferrites we have seen in the discussion of magnetic materials. We will get ferrites. They are the special types of ferrimagnetic materials having very low electrical conductivity. Let us see the second one. The permeability of a material is measured in. How do you measure the permeability? Is it ampere per meter, volt per meter, Henry per meter, or is it dimensionless? Yes, the answer is third one. Third option, Henry per meter. So these are the answers to the quiz questions what we have seen today. So this is what I wanted to tell you in today's class. Thank you all. Thank you very much.